It's December 2018, and a Brazilian pilot, Jezio Barbosa de Moura, is on a routine flight, steering his single-prop Embraer air taxi over the vast Amazon rainforest. The pilot has several passengers on board, and nothing indicates imminent danger. But then a cylinder fails, and it triggers a series of events that led to Barbosa de Moura's mysterious disappearance. A critical aircraft malfunction is never welcome, of course, but there are few places more dangerous to have a breakdown than over the Amazon rainforest. With such extensive tree cover, the Amazon offers scant safe places to make an emergency landing. And the rainforest is a wilderness of such daunting vastness that, without proper preparation, you may never escape or ever be found. In fact, the Amazon covers an area of nearly 2.6 million square miles and is the largest expanse of tropical rainforest on Earth. And Barbosa de Moura found himself experiencing technical problems over the state of Pará in northern Brazil. This is close to the border with French Guiana, above a particularly remote tract on the lower Amazon River. Rich in gold, iron, tin, manganese, and bauxite, Pará has long been explored by roaming extractive industries, which come and go with the seasons. And among the state's derelict outposts is Independencia, an old gold mine with its own airstrip. Barbosa de Moura now flew his plane towards it. The airstrip at Independencia had fallen into disrepair, though, partly consumed by vegetation. It was a highly dangerous place to attempt a landing. But Barbosa de Moura had made his decision. According to the BBC, the pilot said on his radio, "I can't make anything out anymore." And then he fell silent. So the disappearance of Barbosa de Moura, his passenger, and his Embraer air taxi, registration RTRDZ, was evidently caused by a fatal mechanical failure. There was, however, another more scandalous and political dimension to this tragedy. Flaws in Brazil's aviation system, in fact, played a prominent role in the accident, sparking heavy criticism. According to the Aviation Safety Network, which maintains a database of aviation accidents and incidents worldwide, Brazil has experienced the third highest number of fatal accidents globally. Since 1945, in fact, there have been just over 2,700 fatalities in 188 separate incidents. Aviation accidents in Brazil since records began. And while some of them involve large aircraft, most of them concern small or light aircraft of the same or similar type flown by Barbosa de Moura. Small aircraft, specifically air taxis, are frequently the only means of transport in the Amazon, a region with few roads. Indigenous people who live in remote areas will often use these planes when they need to journey to, say, big cities to lodge claims with civil authorities. After all, state pension entitlements require claimants to visit government offices annually in person as evidence that they're living. On December 2, 2018, Barbosa de Moura had been flying from the community of Matawara, a remote indigenous village in the Tumacumacau Mountains National Park. With an area of nearly 15,000 square miles, the park covers an area bigger than Belgium. His intended destination was Laharan Dojari, a mining town of over 40,000 inhabitants in the neighboring state of Amapá. The scheduled flight time was 1 hour and 45 minutes, and it was a familiar route. Barbosa de Moura's passengers included two different parties of indigenous Amazonians. One group contained a teacher, Pantia Tirio, traveling with his wife, Pancina, and their three kids, the youngest of whom was only 3 years old. The second party included a pensioner, Seppi Acurio, who was traveling with a Jessaria Tirio, her son-in-law. Apparently, Acurio was the only person left who could speak her indigenous language and the last known speaker of it in her community in Matawari. Her disappearance is therefore a grave tragedy for her tribe. Barbosa de Moura ran into problems around noon and immediately radioed his longtime friend, Paulo Trindade. The latter, who is also a pilot, was in the air some 22 minutes away. According to the BBC, Barbosa de Moura said over the stuttering intercom, "Paulo, it looks like I've lost a cylinder. There's oil leaking on the windscreen. I'm going to land at Independencia." But Trindade knew this was dangerous, if not a deadly move. He understood that the Independencia airstrip was no longer in service. He told Barbosa de Moura, No, you can't. There's no longer any landing strip there. It was abandoned 15 years ago. Aim for the river, the Paru, instead. Try to land on water. However, Barbarossa Demora, perhaps for reasons of urgency, refused to heed his friend Trindade's advice. Then, after the pilot reaffirmed his decision to head for the abandoned runway, his radio went silent. This prompted Trindade to immediately change course and search for his friend. E2 flew straight into trouble, though, hurtling headlong into an enormous storm. A storm over the Amazon is no little threat to a small airplane. After all, the only way to ensure any visibility in such conditions is to fly beneath it, in fact. So, forced to a low altitude, Trindade progressed slowly. He then arrived at Independencia as the storm ended. But gazing down at the dilapidated airstrip, Trindade saw no indication of any other aircraft. Approximately 48 hours later, the Brazilian Air Force commenced searching the area with Black Hawk helicopters and Hercules transport planes. The officials eventually searched a total of 4,845 square miles and flew a total distance of 12,400 miles in 128 hours, roughly equivalent to flying from Sao Paulo to Tokyo. But with no sign of the plane after 2 weeks, the search ended. But the friends and relatives of the disappeared then launched their own search effort. This began with an 8-day trek from the village of Bona to Independencia. Here, the loved ones set up a base camp close to the dilapidated landing strip. And from there, they conducted forays into the surrounding jungle. Of course, the conditions were challenging. The vegetation was dense and the terrain was far from flat. The researchers therefore spent weeks scouring the surrounding forest, slashing new trails with machetes. But by the end of January 2019, they had depleted their supplies of food, and Chirio's father had fallen ill with malaria, so they were forced to call the search off. But the disappearance of RTRDZ lays bare long-term issues with air traffic control in Brazil. For one thing, the apparent lack of such air traffic control in the Amazon and the seemingly fairly inefficient aviation infrastructure unduly impacts Brazil's indigenous population. And disturbingly, many pilots, including Barbarossa Demora before his disappearance, allegedly have little choice but to operate unlawfully. And because landing strips in remote Amazonian communities tend to fall below official safety standards, they go unregistered with the authorities. Pilots consequently can't legally use them. To meet local transport demands, however, flyers simply submit false flight plans using fake destinations or departure points. Yet, fake flight information tends to confuse search and rescue operations. In March 2019, one Brazilian pilot, Paulo Nortes, explained to the BBC exactly how some pilots avoid official scrutiny. He said, "You have to fly quietly, with the transponder sometimes turned off. The flight controllers and the government don't really know about those flights. You're not being monitored by any controller." "There are a few airstrips that are like roller coasters," he added, describing the nerve-wracking risks of Amazonian flying. "And you must be aware all the time of weather, not to get inside a heavy storm because it plays with your plane as if it were a paper plane, like a toy." And according to Adrian Young, who works for TO70, an aviation consultancy based in the Netherlands, the Brazilian system is nothing short of outrageous. He told the BBC, "A regulatory system that requires pilots to falsify flight plans to lie about basic information is scandalous. It's unsafe. And in such an isolated region, you can't just deny people access to travel." Some civil society groups in Brazil have also spent years lobbying for change. Speaking to the BBC, Cecilia Apalai, an indigenous activist, highlighted the urgency of her plight. She said, "We are very worried because we are the users of this transport system. The landing strips need to be safer, not just for indigenous people themselves, but also for government employees who provide health and education services who use the airstrips all the time." Alexandra Gumiares, the federal prosecutor general of Amapa, actually successfully litigated against the Civil Aviation Authority, ANAC, in 2013. Specifically, the court ruled that ANAC and several other federal organizations must now repair and enhance degraded airstrips throughout Amazonia. Lobbyists argue, though, that the groups do not so far appear to have taken any concrete action. There are 249 landing strips that aren't regulated by the Civil Aviation Authority, and these strips are in indigenous land, Gumiares told the BBC. "All this is the fault of those state bodies that have not carried out their legal duty to regularize these landing strips." Yet, ANAC told the BBC that it's currently mapping areas in places that require landing strips. It also reportedly expects to announce its infrastructure strategy imminently. The organization said, the work aims to facilitate access to services, especially health, for the indigenous population. Discussions are now in a final phase, and plans will be revealed fully as soon as they're approved. Civil society groups have, meanwhile, been lobbying the Defense Ministry to launch a ground search for the missing passengers and pilot of RTRDZ. Such operations are seemingly not without precedent, and an eyewitness sighting of a low-flying plane on the day of the accident arguably bolsters their case. However, the ministry has so far refused to help. For their part, Barbarossa de Mora's family now feel abandoned by the authorities. Speaking to the BBC, his daughter, Flavia Mora, wondered if politics played a role. She said, "We're yelling every day, my brothers and me, begging for any help to continue the search, but no one's come, no one's helped. Is it because they're Indians, because they're ordinary people that no one has offered to help?" Mora added that she cannot have closure or even begin to grieve until the plane is recovered. She continued, "I know this is a pain that will never heal. I can't see him, I can't bury him, I can't say goodbye. And I don't know whether I will see him again one day or whether I'll never know what happened." Aksuni, Pansina's brother, had apparently been unable to join the initial search parties at Independencia, based in Mancapa, the capital of Amapa, a city situated near the mouth of the Amazon River. He had instead remained in daily radio contact with the groups throughout their efforts. And he told the BBC that he was losing faith that his sister was still alive. "We grew up together, we're about the same age, and she lived in the house next to me," Aksuni said. "So we were always talking, we were really close. I used to talk to her, play with her, and now maybe I won't have my sister. I won't have that close person to be with me." Some indigenous groups have echoed Mora's doubts by suggesting that politics may be influencing the apparently lax federal response to the accidents too. Activist Kutanin Wayana, who joined the Independencia ground search, told the BBC that he felt that historical institutional racism likely played a part. "When indigenous people disappear, when they go down in a plane, the government only searches for 14 days because it's an Indian who vanished. Who knows where he or she has gone? For us, this says that, in effect, the government doesn't want to know about indigenous people, doesn't want to know about human lives, human beings." Yet the Brazilian government has taken important measures to address historical racism against indigenous peoples. In 1967, for example, it created the National Indian Foundation, FUNAI, to protect indigenous tribes from colonists and other invaders, demarked indigenous territories, and promote indigenous rights. And on paper, the constitutional rights of indigenous peoples in Brazil are in many ways progressive and well-articulated. In practice, however, indigenous people seemingly argue that their rights are not necessarily respected. For instance, indigenous peoples can lack the agency to successfully challenge threats to their territories and their traditional ways of life. Mining and energy corporations, along with agribusinesses, could therefore stake claims to indigenous lands, with reportedly disastrous results. Ultimately, then, it seems that such companies have a far greater power to lobby government than indigenous activists. And with the election of Jair Bolsonaro in 2018, the Amazon seemingly faces an uncertain future. For instance, one of the president's first moves after assuming office in January 2019 was to strip FUNAI of its power to assign indigenous lands. Bolsonaro's remarks over the years also suggest that he holds allegedly racist views. For example, speaking to the Brazilian newspaper Correio Brasiliense in 1998, Bolsonaro expressed his admiration for the indigenous genocide of North America. He said, "It's a shame that the Brazilian cavalry hasn't been as efficient as the Americans who exterminated the Indians." Ultimately, though, the disappearance of the plane over the Amazon has the appearance of an unfortunate accident, a simple mechanical failure that led to an unsolvable and intractable tragedy. Upon close examination, however, the incident also appears to be entangled in complex political decision-making that takes place far from the communities impacted. And it's not at all clear when, or even if, Brazil's aviation system will be brought more in line with what it's determined.